Hi everyone, my name is Julia Friedlander. I am the Seaborne Gray Senior Fellow and Deputy Director of the Atlanta Council's Geoeconomics Program. And it is my pleasure today to welcome Anna Diamantopoulou to discuss the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development and her candidacy to become its next Secretary General. This is an important conversation to be had about economic governance the day before Joe Biden is inaugurated as the next President of the United States. So without further ado, maybe I'll just, you know, let's chat about why the organization is such an important one for us to understand and why it might need some new leadership.
Thank you, Julia. Last time I was in Atlantic Council, it was in October 2019, but it was physically. Thank you so much for this invitation, a digital one this time, but for a different reason. Let me say just a word about Joe Biden's inauguration. I think it is the first time after the Second World War that so many people expect so much from a single person, symbolically. President Biden's inauguration has created expectations and marks the beginning of a new deal, both for the America and for the rest of the world. And since we are talking about OECD, let me say that the rest of the world expect that Joe Biden will bring America back better in its long-term role, which was a guarantor for multilateralism, and this is OECD about. So coming to your question, OECD is a stabilizer, is an analyst, is a standard setter, and it is a policy pathfinder. And it plays this role in economic terms, but geopolitically as well. And we must have in mind that it contributed to liberal democracies reforming and development after the Second World War, in restructuring and reforming the communist countries after the Cold War, and now is an indispensable pillar of multilateralism, which is the basis of globalization. And Angela Gurria has made a great job, but now we enter a new phase. And in this new phase, first, we must see what OECD has done during the pandemic. It reacted rapidly, and OECD is anticipating what it was going in the world, and it had presented that it had formed concrete policies from health issues, from health governance to digital education. But what it is most important, and I would like to comment, is that this importance of the organization is must be understandable by common people. It must not be reserved in a few technocrats or a few functionaries of governments. And I'll give you two examples. The first one is what OECD has done in tackling tax avoidance. Isn't it a very important issue? And its outputs and its tools had very important to this end. What I mean by that is that OECD supports governments to reduce the losses, the revenue losses. And it is very important because these revenue losses are estimated about $100 to $240 billion. It means 4 to 10% of the global tax revenue of corporate income. It is very important for governments. It is very important that there is an organization which can support governments to bring money in their state budgets, particularly during this time. And it's very important for the well-being of people. The second important paradigm that I would like to give is what it means to set standards. Standards for anti-bribery policies, for investment, for infrastructure, because these standards are the precondition for level playing field. And this is the precondition for eliminating any kind of conflict in the international trade and economy as a whole. And here is China. And it is important that China would adhere to these standards and respect the fair trade rules. And I think we cannot have any compromise on this issue. Therefore, if people understand what OECD does and that it is important for their lives, I think that governments are more legitimized to commit themselves and to work with the organization with concrete results.
Thank you for that. And you've highlighted again how the OECD might be a bit underappreciated in public view, but really plays a very crucial role in setting global standards. If I could ask you, you know, you're head of a prominent Greek think tank now, you've served as a commissioner in Brussels and as a minister in the Greek government. How do these experiences help you at approaching a multilateral organization that where sausage making can often be a little bit difficult?
During these decades, I have got political and managerial experience in three levels, at a local level as a governor, and at a national level as a minister, and at international level as a European commissioner. Two-thirds of my life was in politics, and one-third of my life is in think tanks and universities. I've worked from Asia to the United States. I have set important projects in Africa. I have worked with many universities, among them in Singapore, Lee Kuan Yew, and other universities across the world. So I can combine political work, political experience with scientific and intellectual one. And I think that it is important, I could dare to say that all my interests and specializations have to do with the objectives and the agenda of OECD, from education to labor markets, from competitiveness to growth, from innovation to gender issues. You know, what our times guarantee is that we will be facing with a complex and major crisis. And all these years in public offices have offered me this experience, how to manage this kind of crisis. I've been in the ministerial cabinet during the big economic crisis in Greece in 2009, and we had to overcome it and to proceed with pushing reforms in all sectors and in all levels. And I was commissioner during the enlargement from 2001 to 2004, when 10 new member states came to the European Union. And I had to negotiate with the governments, with multinationals of these countries, and try to ensure that nobody's interest will be harmed off, particularly in sensitive areas as labor market and welfare systems. Another crucial aspect of my experience is that my understanding in real economy and dealing efficiently with this. I've been Minister of Competitiveness and of Growth, and I was responsible for shipping. And I don't know if you know that Greece is the largest ship-owning nation in the world, having operations in each corner of the planet, from Japan to Colombia. In every position I ever held, I always prioritized the consensus-building decision-making, and I've put in the core of this procedure negotiations, which I believe is the essence of leadership and multiculturalism.
Thank you for that. Maybe I could ask you just about three areas, and I think you've alluded to several of them already. The first is how you'll handle fiscal coordination response to the pandemic. I think that the chief economist of the OECD, Laurence Boone, did issue a statement recently saying this is not a time to close our pocketbooks. The second would be on taxation, as you say, but maybe specifically on digital taxation. I was just watching Janet Yellen's confirmation hearing and just a few minutes ago, and she said we should race to the bottom on digital services tax. And then lastly, a bit on climate finance, since it's such a forefront issue globally, but actually also for the, you know, the incumbent.
I'll try in 3 minutes to give the main ideas on these issues. I very much agree with the economists of OECD. State support is still very crucial because it can ensure that jobs and firms remain alive. And of course, it should cease gradually, but when we reach a level of normality. However, we have to, and if we want to contain the consequences of this fiscal expansion, it is important for the governments to invest in, or to invest in projects with high productivity and with high, with as big as possible returns in terms of GDP. And they have to do that in sectors like digital and climate change. And OECD is very well placed to support governments with data and recommendations on these issues. About digital taxation, my first comment is that digital economy needs a lot of different standards. We live in a different era, and OECD can help to organize and to achieve this kind of new agreements. Coming to the digital taxation, globalization and digitization have proved that the existing traditional rules, tax rules, cannot meet the needs of digital economy. So we need a new tax architecture, and this must be based on an underlying principle, which is that profits must be taxed where value is created. I think that what OECD has done, I mean, OECD has brought all these issues on the table, and now an agreement is, many people work for this agreement. If I were elected as a Secretary General, and the agreement has not been yet reached, what I do is that I will use the tools of the OECD to prove through evidence-based studies that national legislation should result in more losses and conflicts between the state and for the enterprises as well. And coming to the climate change, again, OECD can play a role in assisting member states and not only developing countries as well, in channel resources in the most emitting, the five most emitting sectors, and at the same time to attract technologies in order to enhance the potential of green growth. I think that we all know now that the renewable energy creates more jobs in comparison with fossil fuel-based energy. So the challenge is to marry the creation of jobs at the same time to bring emissions down. Greening investments, greening exports, they are all areas that OECD had a lot to do and can support a lot governments. And I think it's extremely important for the common goals we have for the climate issue.
Thank you so much, Ms. Diamantopoulou. Thank you so much for joining us today at the Atlantic Council to discuss your candidacy for the OECD. My cat also wishes you very good luck. You've heard him in the background. Absolutely. Yeah, exactly. Thank you for joining us. And thank you also for helping us highlight the importance of the OECD as an organization.
Thank you very much. And that was the best for the American people.
Thank you.